The next test that I've chosen, which I think is very topical at the moment, DPF pressure sensing. So this is a low pressure sensor circuit. All pressure sensors work on a 0-5 volt range with an active range of around 0.5 to 4.5. The DPF sensor is linear. Now, what I mean by linear is that the pressure in the system can be easily calculated or predicted from the voltage range. For example, the operating range from zero, we live at one bar on the planet, of course, so let's call it atmospheric pressure zero, up to one bar plus above atmosphere. If you've 500 millibar of blockage, half an atmosphere, you would expect 2.5 volts from a sensor. So the prediction is really quite that straightforward. The point of the test is to establish the correct function of the DPF system. In other words, containment of soot, in fact, avoidance of soot is the prime objective of DPF, of course, not containment, to translate voltage output relating to the amount of soot accumulation in the DPF system, from which, and the purpose of this, technically, is to be able to predict accurately what the extent of blockage is, what the correct recovery is, and much more important than any of that, what's caused it in the first place. And that's really what you should be focusing on. So, simple voltage, 0-5 volts. So the connection, in both cases, DPF sensors, very easy to get to, is connected at the back of the sensor. It's a three-wire sensor, output, power, ground. Do not fall in the trap of the possibility that the pipe connecting the DPF sensor to the DPF itself has a hole in it. Therefore, some of the pressure may be escaping. So I know this isn't. I know the DPF sensor is indeed connected securely. So we have potential difference voltage on the blue cable. It's a floating measurement again. Remember the comments about filtration, things like that. I don't like complicating things. In this case, we'll play about, I think, with filtration, just see if there's any benefits. Sample rate, 4 mega samples, pretty much standard sample rate for me. And the time base, remember the 3 time base suggested? 1 millisecond, 100 milliseconds, and 5 seconds per division. That gives us 50 seconds for a profile. So, let's make the adjustments. Free run, no filtering, no triggering. I would much rather use time than trigger. 0-5 volts, that sets the range. And you'll notice that when you multiply time, you multiply noise. So any noise in the circuit, the lower the voltage, the more background noise. 5 seconds, and you'll notice the line appears reasonably thick. That's the noise from the rest of the electrical circuit and indeed the environment. We're ready to go. So let's start the engine, operate the throttle. Now, first of all, the plausibility voltage in DPF, most of the plausibility voltages are 0.5, which we've got. So 5 volt range, we're at 0.5. There are one or two sensors that do give you a slightly higher plausibility value. What's the first part of the observation? Is that on startup of the engine, that voltage should not increase more than maybe 0.1 at the most. If it does, we've got a problem, because at idle speed, the pressure in a diesel engine should, in the exhaust stream, should not increase. When we open the throttle with a static vertical, I do not want to see more than 1.3 volts maximum. I would very much like to see less than 1 volt. So those are the parameters we're looking for. Capture the event. Now that we've captured the event, well, the first observation, a very simple one, this looks a very healthy system indeed. In other words, there's not a lot of deflection in the positive direction relating to pressure in the system. Let's have a look in much more detail, because there seems to be a certain amount of thickening of the line against this section here. Well, that is actual real-time measurement of pressure differential in the exhaust system. So let's take a look at, this is a plausibility voltage, which I suggested should be 0.5. We then started the Wirtel. So this is actual differential pressure in the system during the cranking phase. And you can see initially, it does increase a little, but we're only going up to about, there's 0.8, 1.1. We're only going up to about 1 volt. But having started the engine, you can see there is virtually no difference. So you get obviously positive and negative pressure cycles in the exhaust stream, but the average voltage hasn't really increased from a static engine. That's first good news. Then if we go back to where we actually increase the engine throttle, now once again, because this is an automatic, we can't get maximum RPM. You can see there is a slight pressure change. This looks like background noise, it's not. Once again, quite a high sample rate allows us to zoom into these events and again and prove conclusively that this is actual pressure differential. And it's peaking at 0.9, give or take. Well, you know what, guys? That's about as good as it gets in this system. So I can predict that the maximum pressure in this system is somewhere around 50 millibars, maybe 60 millibars of pressure. Well under the value I expect. Maximum value at idle, 100 millibar, 120 millibar. On the road, on full load, 220 maximum for a perfect system. So I'm encouraged by that. I don't see any issues. So in terms of prediction of the performance of a DPF, it really is that quick. And that is the very first test I will conduct on the car. The very first thing I will do when approaching a DPF problem, of course, is what we call customer profiling. I want to know how the customer drives the car. I want to know where they drive it. I want to know what fuel they buy. I want to know what oil they use. I want to know how it's serviced. That is 9/10 of the problem and the environment which they operate it in. Once I understand that, I can then help them to avoid the problem. Is it a technical problem with a failure of the car to convert soot to CO2 rather than to store it for later active regeneration? In which case we can then hopefully help them to resolve the problem before it becomes a failure. In this case, that's a perfect result. The next challenge is, I guess, to prove if the sensor is accurate throughout the range. So what I'd like to do is, now this is a pressure differential sensor. So it's measured pressure before the DPF and relating it to a differential of atmospheric pressure, the residual pressure after the DPF. So we either put a positive pressure in front of it, which we haven't because it's not blocked, or we put a negative pressure after the sensor. So I'm going to use a suction pump, vacuum pump, to provide a pressure at the back of the sensor to prove its range. So rather than apply a positive pressure at the front, we're going to apply a negative pressure at the back of it and prove the range performance using the scope. So short break, we'll set that test up and then I'll show you how that works. So what I've done is connected a vacuum pump on the rear port of the differential sensor. This normally is exposed to the exhaust system at the back of the DPF, therefore theoretically would be atmospheric pressure. So by applying a negative pressure on this port, I'm effectively creating a positive force on the other side, differential. And let's wait until the sweep time begins a new screen. I'm going to apply an increasing amount of suction. That's minus 25, 26, 27, come on. About 28 inches of mercury, about 0.75 of an atmosphere. So it won't or shouldn't make 4.5 volts. I'm going to release that pressure. And let's have a look at the performance of the sensor. So this is going to prove range as well, because I've got control of the forces applied. You can see the steps represents my hand motion on the suction pump. So we start with half a volt of plausibility, and we've actually got 4.5 volts. Yes, 4.425. That means that's the maximum range at which that sensor can operate. And we also have these gauges built as well for accuracy. We don't rely on a lot of the gauges that are available to us. We have them built by a specialist company to our specification. I had 25, 26, 27 inches of mercury. Well, 30 inches is minus one bar, so you're looking about 0.8 of a bar, thereabouts, maybe 0.85 of a bar of negative pressure. That would be the equivalent of 0.8 of an atmosphere above atmosphere, 0.8 of a bar above atmosphere of pressure. So by applying a negative pressure, if it's differential, two ports, apply a negative pressure to the rear port and check the range of the sensor, therefore proving the sensor is actually capable of reporting pressure differential across the entire range. Very effective, very accurate, and it gives you a scaling as well. You can now, from that, understand what sort of voltage represents a problem within the DPF system. And really, in my books, anything above 300 millibar is a problem. You don't want to be seeing soot shouldn't be contained. You should be preventing soot, which is passive regeneration, conversion of soot into CO2. But that's another subject. But there's the test. Simple test. So any pressure sensor, whether it be pressure differential, whether it be a MAP sensor, whether it be a turbo boost sensor, that is a standard test for that particular component. Free run, 50 seconds of time base, no filtering, very focused test, and it proves accuracy and range.